Thank you for tuning in to the Postmodern Realities Podcast from the Christian Research Institute and the Christian Research Journal. I'm Melanie Cogdill, Managing Editor of the Christian Research Journal. It's February 2021, and you're listening to episode 221, which is a discussion about the work of 19th century British poet Alfred Lord Tennyson. On this episode, I'm joined by Dr. Louis Marcos, who holds the Robert H. Ray Chair in the Humanities at Houston Baptist University. He is the author of more than 18 books, including the recently released The Myth Made Fact, Reading Greek and Roman Mythology Through Christian Eyes. Lou has written an online exclusive feature article about Tennyson for the Christian Research Journal, and his article is called Tennyson on Theodicy, How a Victorian Poet Can Help Modern Christians Deal with the Problem of Pain. You can read his article when you subscribe to our journal for $33.50 at our website, equip.org. And just a note, all of these online exclusive feature articles, film reviews, television reviews, and other cultural apologetics articles that we have been featuring on this podcast are now exclusively available for those who subscribe to our journal. Lou, it's good to have you on.
It's great to be back.
Well, as I mentioned, Lou has written for us a feature article on the poet Alfred Lord Tennyson, and he was somebody who lived in the Victorian age, which I don't know how many people these days, especially a younger generation, are all that familiar with poetry from the Victorian age in Britain. And so I think it's really interesting. Now, a lot of people will ask us why we even have literary apologetic articles, and I would like you to answer that briefly first before I ask you a little bit more about your particular article and the context of it. I mean, why should people even care in Christian apologetics about a British poet who, you know, lived many hundreds of years ago?
That's a great and important question, Melanie. I think I'll preface it. I've been teaching at Houston Baptist University for 30 years. And over the last few years, we started a master's in cultural apologetics. Now, what does that mean? What the person that really helped start it was Holly Ordway, who writes often for CRJ, a very good writer. And a typical apologetics, especially in America, focuses on logic, reason, science, history. These are all very important things, but too often they leave out the imaginative side. And cultural apologetics means we want to appeal to the full person, not only the reason, but also the emotion and the imagination. And a lot of times people, they may believe something in their head, but if it doesn't become real in their heart, it's not going to go anywhere, right? It's that difficulty of moving something from head knowledge into heart knowledge. And reason may tell us what's true, but we often need the imaginative side to tell us why is it true and why does it matter and what does it mean to me. The arts are just by nature incarnational. The arts take ideas and themes, love and freedom and all those things, but it takes those ideas and incarnates them, makes them real, gives them a particularity, if I can get that word. It makes a story out of them. And if you think of the Bible, much of the Bible is systematic. We think of the books of Romans or something like that. But much of the Bible, at least half of the Bible, is narrative. It tells us the story that God is doing in human history. And I think if we leave out the imaginative, the artistic side, we're leaving out the part of us that makes decisions, that lives life, that takes God's truth and lives it out in our lives. So I think it's an important dimension. And I'm so glad CRJ is giving so much space to literary apologetics.
Yeah, I think that it does help for people to consider imagination and, you know, the role of the arts especially in the life of the Christian. But more than that, it seems that that's some a real way in which we can engage people who are not Christians to think about various themes that maybe approaching it in the typical way in which philosophy does might not engage them as much as talking about books. And in this case today, poetry. Now, I would say that I was an English major in college, and I would say that most people would find poetry rather obtuse. They don't really understand it, particularly some, you know, poetry that we're going to be talking about in this episode in the Victorian age. It seems hard for them to grasp what it means or what it's talking about. And then, you know, just why we should grapple with some of the themes in poetry. But, and especially thinking about the Victorian era, which is in the 1800s, that just seems so far removed from our time now. And so I think a lot of listeners would be wondering, how could the struggles of someone who lived in the Victorian era be similar to our own struggles? And before you address that, why don't you just tell us a little bit about this particular poet, Tennyson, and the context of the poem that we're going to be speaking about today. Why did he write it, and what was the focus of it?
The Victorian age is in England, and it's the second two-thirds of the 19th century. The first third of the 19th century is what we call the Romantic Age, that was born out of the French Revolution. Those are poets like Wordsworth, Coleridge, Blake, Byron, Shelley, Keats. But as we move into the remaining two-thirds of British history in the 19th century, during the reign of Queen Victoria, less and less are people concerned about the romantic concern of sort of introspection and looking backwards towards a lost Garden of Eden. They're moving away from focusing on personal concerns. And as we move into the Victorian age, this is the period of great industrial expansion. The British Empire is growing. Technology is growing. Progress is growing. And as we move into the Victorian age, we get a new set of poets who are more engaged in public issues, public struggles, not so much private struggles. When we read the Romantics, whom I love, we feel like we're reading their diary entry, their journal entry, as they're dealing with their own inner demons. But as we move into the Victorian age, we get a more public kind of poetry that wants to wrestle with the issues of the age. And going back to your first question, why a Victorian poet is so important, I would argue that in many ways, the Victorian age is the age most like our own. And the reason I say that is that the struggles of the Victorian age are ones that we're still struggling with today, especially if you are a Christian, especially if you're an evangelical Christian, we're still struggling with these issues. Now, number one and most important, the Victorian age is the age when an evolutionary framework takes over with the new science. People struggled with evolution back then, just like they struggle with it today. And they not only struggle with the natural, you know, what they call natural selection or survival of the fittest, they're also struggling with the age of the earth, right? But it's not just that. The 19th century is the age of the machine. It's the age when the Industrial Revolution has taken over and people start asking questions like, you know, is progress an absolute good or does progress have a dark side? Can we build utopia? And even if we can build it, should we try to build it? What about science itself? Is it a good or a bad? Is science a better way to reach truth than religion or the arts or anything like that? All of these, even questions about authority, all of these questions are stirring. And England is the first place to really struggle with these. Then it spreads out across Europe. It spreads to America. It spreads to the rest of the world. But the Victorian age in England is the place when that happens. So the three most important and best known of the Victorian poets are Alfred Lord Tennyson, Robert Browning, and Matthew Arnold. And they're all great poets that are worth studying. But Tennyson is the one I like to look at because of all the 19th century poets, Tennyson is the one that most embodied his age, that most wrestled with the issues of his age. And he did it particularly in his masterwork, In Memoriam, which is what we're going to talk about today, Melanie, and what my article is about. Now, you asked, what is the origin of In Memoriam? So let me sort of step back and say that one of the interesting thing about poets, if you are, let's say, a Victorian poet, that generally means you grew up in the previous age or the Romantic age. And so Tennyson grew up in the Romantic age, but he slowly transitions into the Victorian age. And so he is very conscious of being and becoming a Victorian poet who wants to wrestle with the issues of his day and embody those issues and be able to help not only himself, but the public who are reading his poem. So he is very conscious. He's as conscious as somebody writing prose, somebody writing essays. He's writing in poetry, but he wants his poetry to be read not only for entertainment, because it's pretty, okay? But he wants people to read it as a way of struggling and wrestling and grappling with the issues of the day. Now, what's interesting about Tennyson is if something didn't happen in his life, he might have continued being a romantic poet. His early poetry is very romantic, very inward focused, very emotional focused inside. And Tennyson was a very shy young man, and he went to Cambridge, and he was still very shy, but then he got a friend named Arthur Henry Hallam. And Hallam is the kind of friend every shy person needs. Hallam is the person that helped to draw Tennyson out of his shell, bring him into a group of like-minded friends, and help him to get a public voice. Now, at this point, Hallam was very much a romantic, and he was encouraging the romantic poems of Tennyson, and it might have continued. But then, tragically, when Hallam was only 21 years old, he died. He was overseas in Vienna, and he died suddenly and unexpectedly, and it just rocked Tennyson's world. Tennyson and Hallam were the best of friends. They took walking tours together. They walked the Alps. They did all these things together. And in fact, Hallam was engaged to one of Tennyson's sisters. So the two best friends were about to become brother-in-laws. And then suddenly, out of the blue, in the year 1832, Hallam dies suddenly, and Tennyson is catapulted into grief. Now, we all deal with grief in a different way. Tennyson was a poet, and one of the ways he dealt with grief was through his poetry. And so while he was writing his regular poems, while he was getting them published, all of that stuff, he was writing private poems just for himself, never intending to publish them, but he was writing them as an emotional outlet. And so he wrote these poems over a period of many, many years. He was writing these poems, still no thought of publication. But as the number of poems increased, I mean, eventually reaching 131, that's how many poems they were, as they increased, Tennyson began to think, you know, maybe these poems would help other people who are going through grief. And you see, even as Tennyson wrote them himself, he started by writing poems dealing with his own personal grief over the loss of Hallam. But as he matured, as he wrote, he started writing poems not only about the loss of a friend, but about the loss of an earlier, simpler way of life, almost about a loss of innocence. And he began to wrestle in himself with the new science and the new industrialism and all those sorts of things. Now, finally, when he got ready, he published it in 1850, and it was an overnight success. But here is why I believe this poem is so important for people and why it is the best poem or best work ever written on grief. A lot of poets, when they published the poem as a collection, they might have been tempted to go back to the early poems and change them, to make them sound less grieving and less doubting. But Tennyson didn't do that. I mean, he edited them to make them purer, but he allowed us to have a real, authentic chronicle of a man's grief and how it went through different stages until it achieved a higher and richer faith. The best way I can explain this, Melanie, a lot of your readers, I hope, are fans of C.S. Lewis, and Lewis wrote a book called A Grief Observed, which is the second best book to read on grieving. And some of them will know that Lewis was a lifelong bachelor, but towards the end of his life, he married a woman named Joy, and she died. And Lewis was devastated, even though he was a strong Christian apologist. He was devastated. And in order to take care of it, instead of keeping a journal of poetry, he kept a journal of prose, writing down everything he was feeling, all the struggles. Finally, after he filled up four notebooks filled with these reflections, he thought, you know, maybe this book, these reflections, would help other people, especially Christians who are grieving. And so he published it anonymously at first under the title of A Grief Observed. Now, the reason it's the second greatest book on grieving is, thank God, when he published the book, Lewis did not go back and tidy up the early sections to make them sound less doubting. Please, if you want to read Lewis, don't make A Grief Observed your first book, because when you read it, you're going to think, is this the great Christian apologist? He sounds like he's doubting everything. But you know what? That's what happens to believers. And so when you read A Grief Observed, you are literally watching a man of faith go through a period of doubt and then work his way through God's grace back to a stronger faith. Well, that's what makes A Grief Observed great. That's what makes In Memoriam great. It allows us to follow a man who is a believer. We'll talk about later, maybe he's not as conservative a believer as certainly I am or many of CRJ people, but he certainly had a faith, and we get to follow alongside as Tennyson struggles with personal, private, and public issues and moves to a higher faith that I think can challenge believers today and help us in our own struggles.
You're listening to the Postmodern Realities Podcast from the Christian Research Institute and the Christian Research Journal. Today's guest is Dr. Lewis Marcos, who has written an online exclusive feature article about the 19th century poet Tennyson. His article is called Tennyson on Theodicy, How a Victorian Poet Can Help Modern Christians Deal with the Problem of Pain. And you can read his article when you subscribe to our journal for $33.50 at our website, equip.org. Now, I hope you noted that this is an online exclusive, so it's available right now on our website, equip.org, and you can easily access it if you are a subscriber to the Christian Research Journal. So as we started 2021, we wanted to make sure that we brought our subscribers some extra goodies just for them that are some exclusive things that they can have on our website, and that includes all the articles that you'll hear about on this podcast. So if you'd like to read those, you don't have to wait for them to be in print. They're available right now. You just have to subscribe to our journal. And another way we want to thank you is if you could help us out by just telling a friend about this podcast. It's the best way that you can spread the word about it, as well as link to any of the landing pages for your favorite episodes on your social media accounts. And as always, we're really grateful for any reviews, whether starred or written at Apple Podcasts, for why you listen to this podcast. So we're very grateful for that. And we thank you for all the ways you partner with us, including if you would like to give us a tip for our content to help us to keep producing this content and bring it to you for free on the podcast. You can do that at equip.org. Just go to the main page. Just go to Magazine Postmodern Realities at the drop down. And at any of the landing pages for any episode, you will find a link where you can give us a tip. And thank you for your support. Well, you were just unpacking for us a little bit the context of, you know, the genesis of this poem by Tennyson, In Memoriam. And what it really was trying to deal with in terms of grief. And, you know, I think a lot of modern people in memoriam, we just remember that's at any time there's an award show, they always show us like who has died, just pictures of famous actors or directors or something like that, in like at the Oscars. But this is something different. This is kind of, you know, really unpacking grief. And, you know, you mentioned at the beginning of this episode that this time in the Victorian era wasn't like the romantic poets at the beginning of the 1800s, but rather there was so much going on. There was it was a time of progress and all these different things that were happening specifically in Britain at that time. And so I want to ask you, because you're saying that, yes, it is about grief over his very close friend who dies suddenly, Hallam, but also it's grief over some other issues. And so how does this, you know, poem grapple with other issues in addition to the actual grief over the death of his friend?
Now, when you read the early sections of In Memoriam, again, it's what you expect, you know, grief, the personal loss, the private loss. But as we move into In Memoriam, again, 131 separate poems, all linked together. As we move deeper into it, Tennyson starts to realize he's not just a personal griever, but he's now a public wrestler. All right, anybody, especially if you're doubting in your faith, we struggle when somebody dies. And what we struggle with is, will I ever see my friend again, right? Are we really immortal? Will I see my friend again? Is there purpose? Is it just death in a world of death and it doesn't lead to anything? I mean, most of us can handle grief. What we can't handle is when the grief seems to be meaningless. In other words, I'm just grieving in a world of darkness and it's not leading to anything. If our grief can make us stronger people with a stronger faith, more closely tied to the Lord, more understanding our fellow man. Most of us can handle grief that leads to something higher. But when the grief seems to be just a cycle that leads nowhere, it magnifies the grief. And we need to understand that In Memoriam, most of the writing of In Memoriam was done 20 years before Darwin published Origin of Species. But Tennyson was enough of a reader of science, he could see where things were going. And Melanie, what we call evolution today, did not begin in the biological sciences as it did with Darwin. It began earlier in geology. The older understanding of geology was what we call catastrophic, right? We have a world, and it's things like the global flood of Noah that shaped the world we know of with its, you know, mountains and its volcanoes and things like that. That was the traditional view called catastrophic. But at the time Tennyson was writing, before Darwin, there was a guy named Lyell, and he wrote about what he called uniformitarianism. And that was the idea that the Earth is billions of years old, and everything we see is the result of slow, gradual change. Random, arbitrary, doesn't know where it's going, just slow, gradual change. And that was slowly building up to Darwin and to this idea, even before Darwin mentioned what we call natural selection or survival of the fittest. Tennyson saw where it was going. What the new science suggested is that the individual life doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is the species. It used to mean that every individual life had individual value. But now it seemed like all of our individual lives was so much manure and so much lime for an uncaring naturalistic process. And as Tennyson thought about that, it made him feel like he was cut off in a world that has no meaning. It used to be that, you know I'm special because God doesn't make any junk, as people used to say. But Tennyson starts to worry. He says, wait a minute, I'll read a little poetry. He says, behold, we know not anything. I can but trust that good shall fall at last far off at last to all, and every winter change to spring. I can only hope vainly that a spring is coming, but I don't see it now. So runs my dream. But what am I, an infant crying in the night, an infant crying for the light, and with no language but a cry? He feels cut off in the dark, where purpose seems to be moving away from him, and science seems to suggest a world that is uncaring, a world that is not causing suffering for a higher purpose, but it's just a world of suffering and it as an end in and of itself. See, Tennyson, we'll talk about here, okay, with Darwin, the ideal of survival of the fittest, okay, what does that mean? Tennyson is already seeing it. This is what it means. He explains it. It means that I, considering everywhere her secret meaning in her deeds, nature's secret meaning, and finding that of 50 seeds, she often brings but one to bear. What he starts to see in nature is there could be 100 animals, but it's okay if 99 die because only one needs to survive to pass on its genetic material. Now, we're jumping ahead to later understanding, but Tennyson's already seen where the new science is going. And you understand it is the opposite of the good shepherd, right? Where he's got, I'm combining some things Jesus says, where the shepherd has 100 sheep, and one runs away, and he leaves the 99 alone to go and get that one sheep and put it over his shoulders, and it rejoices, just like we rejoice over the prodigal son. That's what Tennyson used to believe, but science seems to say, no, okay, we don't care, okay? Everything is just cannon fodder. It's okay if it all dies. All that matters is that the species survives. And when he thinks about that, this is what Tennyson says. When I think about that image of what will be called natural selection, I falter where I firmly trod, and falling with my weight of cares upon the great world's altar stairs that slope through darkness up to God. I stretch lame hands of faith and grope and gather dust and chaff and call to what I feel is Lord of all, and faintly trust the larger hope. Now, if you listen carefully, the image here is the image of Jacob's ladder. But Jacob's ladder has the angels of God going up and down between God and us. And ultimately, Jesus is Jacob's ladder. But now, with this sense of an uncaring nature, and therefore perhaps an uncaring creator, it seems like when I look up Jacob's ladder, all I see is darkness. I don't see God at the top. I don't even see the angels ascending and descending. As he achieves what we might call a dark night of the soul, suddenly it seems so bleak. It seems like, again, only the species matters. The individual is meaningless.
Well, I just want to press in a little bit about his view of the implications of Darwinism. A few moments ago, you mentioned that he wrote his poems more than two decades before Darwin's work, Origin of Species. So what other, besides what you've kind of unpacked for us already, what other implications did Tennyson see about Darwinism and that kind of a view? In comparison with, like you were saying, the, you know, personal nature of considering the death of his friend.
Good. He realized, and again, it's amazing. It's like he was wrestling before Darwin even wrote his book, helping us to understand. It seemed to suggest, when you really look at, if you know Darwin's true, you know what it really says? It doesn't even say the individual is unimportant, only the species is important. Because actually, even the species is not important, because whole species have gone extinct, like the dinosaurs, because they were already finding bones and things like that. And Tennyson said, wait a minute, maybe even the human race will go extinct. And so Tennyson is wrestling with this idea that, again, that we as human beings, we spent all these thousands of years building, you know, writing hymns, building cathedrals, doing things, trying to build a world of justice, trying to bring mercy. We've done all these things. And then in a moment of horror, Tennyson says, but wait a minute, we're just going to end up as fossils locked up in dusty hills like the dinosaurs. If then we are the most pathetic of all people, because at least the dinosaurs didn't think that they were the great people that were making the world better. They just ate and lived and died. But we have this idea that we're special, created in the image of a special God. And yet, as he looks closer, not only the death of Hallam, but the death of nature around him, it seems to be speaking of nihilism. It seems to speak a world where nature is red in tooth and claw and doesn't care at all about that. And that's the struggle that he's trying to move out of. Is there any hope? When I look at nature, all I seem to see is nature red in tooth and claw, no meaning, no personality, just everything going extinct ultimately.
So thinking about his relationship and his special connection with his friend Hallam, as he considered that, how did it resolve Tennyson's fears about immortality and some of these issues that you've been unpacking for us?
Okay, what happens, and it's really amazing, and if you want to look it up, it's number 54, 55, 56. I'm focusing on those because that's where he really deals with the new science. And he says, again, the dragon, the dinosaurs were better off. But then he ends number 56 by saying, "Oh, life as futile then as frail. Oh, for thy voice to soothe and bless. What hope of answer or redress behind the veil, behind the veil." Now, when he says thy voice, he's actually not meaning God right now. He is reaching out to God, but he actually means Hallam. Now, why? He's not trying to deify Hallam, but he's saying, if I can find any proof that Hallam is still alive, that he's not just dead and extinct like the dinosaurs, if I can find any proof that Hallam is still there, then I'll know that everything's not futile. Then I'll know that there's some kind of life after death. He's grasping for anything right now. And that's number 56. We have to go all the way to number 95 to finally reach one of the climaxes of the poem. And it's a story that Tennyson tells. It's about 3 years after the death of Hallam. And it's getting around Christmas, New Year's time. And he's with his family, and they're all having a party, and they're all outside, and it's a beautiful, peaceful night, and Tennyson describes it in the most beautiful poetry. But then, as the evening comes on, one by one, all of his family members go back in the house to sleep, and Tennyson is alone. And as he's alone there in the quiet and stillness, he begins in his mind to go back over his friendship with Hallam, to relive it. And he says, "A hunger seized my heart. I read of that glad year which once had been in those fallen leaves which kept their green, the noble letters of the dead." As if their friendship was a book, he begins to read it and relive it. And as he does, something happens. He says, "And strangely on the silence broke the silent speaking words. And strange was love's dumb cry, defying change to test his worth. And strangely spoke the faith, the vigor, bold to dwell on doubts that drive the coward back, and keenly through wordy snares to track suggestion to her inmost cell." What he's saying here is, as he pushes farther and deeper, suddenly a stronger love emerges, a love that can look past death, a love that can look past doubt, a love that defies even change to take away the strength of, "For love is as strong as death and unyielding as the grave." I'm not quoting Tennyson, that's the Song of Solomon. "Many waters cannot put out love." He's trying to find that kind of a love. It's coming to him, a love that is unafraid of doubt, that pushes even to questions with a stronger faith. And suddenly he feels the presence of Hallam. For a moment, it's as if the two touch each other and their souls come together and are flung kind of throughout the universe, and suddenly he moves beyond his grief. And it's just a brief touch, but it opens him to the possibility of life. Now, again, he's looking for anything. This is not Christianity. This is not the resurrection of the body. There is a little bit of a danger. This is not a seance. Okay, this is Tennyson truly trying to reach out and feel just some kind of touch, something from on the other side of the grave. He's going to move past that, but it begins there. It begins with a faith that again, remember what St. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15. If it is only for this world we have faith, right? Then we are the most, you know, if we think that if we don't think Christ rose from the dead, if we think that we die and that's it, then we are miserable. Tennyson is groping after that stronger faith, the faith that can look through death to something richer.
So, you know, we're living here in the 21st century. So as modern Christians, you know, consider this work, and especially Tennyson's insights or how he's thinking about science and evolution, how should we really interpret that in terms of do we want to see things the same way that he saw it? Like, how can we use some of those things that he's thinking through, you know, as a springboard for apologetics, or maybe something that we need to be cautious about taking that exact interpretation to what we need to address today in terms of evolution?
It's an important question. We can learn from Tennyson, but we also have to be discerning as we learn from him. And what happens later in the poem, it's number 118, if you want to look it up. At first, his face was so close up to this whole survival of the fittest that he couldn't get any perspective. And then he pulls back finally, and he looks at it again. And as he looks again at nature and everything he sees, he suddenly starts to say, wait a minute, this is not meaningless. There is progress going on here. We are moving closer and closer. There is a kind of improving that is going on. We're moving and moving forward. Now, Tennyson lived in a time when, again, he was starting to think that evolution had been proved. And so the Tennyson of back then really is much closer to theistic evolution. I would hope if Tennyson lived today and saw everything we now know about the DNA and the complexity of everything, I can't imagine him being a theistic evolutionist, because he's always looking for God's direct purpose. But at the time he lived, the best he could come up with is a kind of evolution that is being guided from above. And Tennyson found hope in something, Melanie, that has been disproven. But at first, he found hope in what's called embryology. Now, it was just in its origins. And there was this guy who showed pictures of the embryo and how, when you look at the embryo, they're called the Haeckel drawings, how in the very early stages, you know, we look like a little tadpole and a little frog and a little fetal pig. And it was almost as if in the womb, we were going through all the stages of evolution. Now, Melanie, I hope CRJ readers know that those Haeckel drawings have now been shown to actually be a forgery. He actually changed them. And now that we have better embryology, we know that at the earliest stages, we're absolutely distinct. Okay, so this has actually been disproven, even though it appears in still every single evolution book that seems to be printed. But Tennyson didn't know that. And so Tennyson tried to say, well, in each individual human being, it was as if we were going through the whole evolutionary process. Now, again, he's still working within his time frame, but at least he's trying to see that there's real purpose. Whereas the new atheists say that what we see in nature is only the appearance of purpose, the appearance of design, Tennyson clearly saw purpose and design. And I really think if he lived today, I don't think he would have been a six literal day kind of person, but I think he would have been more an intelligent design because he was looking for design, but he couldn't break out of his period. It just, he didn't have he didn't have a fossil record that disproved Darwin. Let's put it that way. Okay. But what he saw, and again, I'm going to show you the good and dark side here. What he saw was man improving, right? He saw us moving from a more primitive state to a more civilized state. And again, working with Darwin, he thought, well, maybe just as we went from amoeba to man, maybe as a species, we're going from caveman to the more cultivated man. Okay, now, in one sense, this was good. He believed that God used suffering to improve us. And the Bible itself uses imagery of gold that's tried in the fire. God uses our trials to strengthen and purify our faith the way gold is purified. Now, the way Tennyson talks about it is he calls it, let the ape and tiger die. Let the primitive side of ourselves give way to a more civilized. Now, in one sense, that's good because he's understanding that God is working with us as a human species, but there's also a downside. I think Tennyson would have been horrified by this, but unfortunately, a lot of what comes out of the Victorian age is a kind of utopianism that has a overly optimistic view of humanity. Instead of original sin, they had this idea that if we could just work out our ignorance and our primitivism, we could build utopia. And of course, that proved to be completely untrue. Also, unfortunately, this kind of thinking, if we divorce it from the clear understanding that we were made in God's image and so we all have unique and essential worth, but we are fallen and so can't build utopia, what happened was they didn't know we were fallen, and so they thought we could build utopia, but unfortunately, they did not understand the essential worth and value. And so a lot of this Darwinian evolution led to racism. It led to Hitler. It led to eugenics. It led to this idea that the African people were more primitive and less evolved than people in the West. And so this stuff led to the eugenics of our own country in the early 20th century. Margaret Sanger wanted to breed out a better race. She was very clearly a racist. She was pretty open about it because she took Darwinism at face value. Now, I do believe as we read Tennyson, we see that he's yearning to move beyond that, but we need to see that there is a danger. I think there's even a danger in what's called theistic evolution. Heck, I think it was Lee Strobel that said, how can God direct an undirected process? I think we need something beyond theistic evolution. But Tennyson is, I believe, one of the first Christians who's trying to find a way to bring these, to build a bridge, to say, okay, I see this in nature, but we also need to see that behind it is a loving God who is using suffering to bring us closer to himself. So again, I think we need to wrestle with In Memoriam. We need to see it as of its time and understand its limitations. But at the same time, I think it can help us to step back and look and really wrestle and try to see what God is doing on a deeper level when we're so caught up in our own grief.
That's interesting that you're mentioning these views of utopia because, I mean, we're, you know, almost 200 years past that, and we're still wrestling with those very same issues in terms of, you know, how can humanity be better so that we can, you know, have utopia here on Earth in, you know, various different forms. And so what is the takeaway for Christians today? Like, what can they learn from this poem and his testimony? And how can they use what they're learning as really as a springboard for discussions with people who are not Christians, who don't believe in God?
We have to see that we all wrestle with grief, you know, unless we die very young. We all wrestle with grief, and we wrestle with grief because we have a deep, essential understanding that there is purpose and meaning. And that if we just die and we die, it just seems like a cruel joke. Now, I know there are people who say, well, before I was born, I was nothing. So I go back into nothing. What's the big deal? I mean, there are people like that. But I think when you scratch under the surface, people are really wrestling with this. Now, one thing that Tennyson came to a point where he said, you know what? I can't use science to prove God. But that also means I can't use science to disprove God. Okay, so, I mean, that may be a little bit of a cop-out, but I think it's a bridge that we can build. Okay, let's move beyond that. Let's look to where is the purpose? Why do we even grieve? Okay, I mean, you know, if survival of the fittest is true, that's the way it should be. Okay, we shouldn't be grieving. And yet we do, we understand. And so what we have in memoriam is a human document of someone trying to make sense of the world. And I think one of the best ways to start to make this connection with people, something I kind of learned from C.S. Lewis, as I've learned so many things, people often say, how can there be a God in this world when there is so much injustice, when young people like Hallam die? How can there be a God? And your response in a loving way is, if there is no God, then how do you know the world is unjust? If there is no God, then all there is survival of the fittest. And there is no such thing as justice or injustice. The very fact that you recognize injustice in the world shows that you have a sense of justice. But where did your sense of justice come from? It couldn't have come from the natural world if all the natural world shows us is red in tooth and claw. There must be something higher, right? Let me sort of end here. When Tennyson comes to the end, he ends up with a little bit more subjective faith. He just, I feel it, right? And he cries up and he says at the end, he ends up like a child in doubt and fear. But that blind clamor made me wise. Then was I as a child that cries, but crying knows his father near. In the beginning is that complete feeling of existential grief. There's nothing there. But if we press on, sometimes we realize we're not alone in the dark. And from there, we can slowly move. I mentioned A Grief Observed by C.S. Lewis. One of the climaxes of that wonderful book is when Lewis comes up with an analogy for his life. And he says, picture a man in total darkness. Because he's in the dark, he thinks he is deep under the earth in a dungeon. And there he sits in despair. And suddenly, he hears a sound. It might be the sound of cattle lowing on a distant hill or water burbling over a brook. But suddenly, when he hears that sound, he realizes that he's not in a dungeon, but he is out in the open air. Now, in one sense, nothing has changed. He still waits in darkness, but now he knows that the world is bigger, that there is, in fact, an unseen realm. And sometimes it just takes that very small beginning. But from then, we need to move out and we need to ask our question, where is this sense of hope and purpose coming from? It can't be coming from nature itself. It needs to be coming from outside of nature because it speaks of a purpose and a meaning that transcends nature. And Tennyson is someone that struggles with this and moves toward it. And some of it seems like simple subjectivism, just my feeling. But no, Tennyson wants something beyond. And we've got to find out, do you really want to find a God? Because if you find that God, you're going to be accountable to that God. So we need to make it very clear. And Tennyson actually wants to know that there's a personal God out there. He's not afraid. He is on a real quest or pilgrimage. And I think we can encourage people to go on that pilgrimage, but to be a honest seeker, someone who wants to find truth out there and is willing to allow that truth to radically change their lives.
Well, finally, on a completely different note, I want to have Lou answer some rapid fire questions. And so, Lou, you live in Texas. So Texas barbecue or Tex-Mex?
Oh, Texas barbecue.
Are you an early bird or a night owl?
I am definitely a night owl.
And we've been talking about the poet Tennyson. So who is your favorite poet?
Oh, single favorite poet has to be Dante, but Tennyson's up there on the list.
And I mentioned that you live in Texas. So what's your favorite thing about living in Texas?
Wow. Well, I grew up in New Jersey, went to school in New York and Michigan, and I do not miss the cold. And even though I love Houston, my real favorite thing to do is go visit my son in San Antonio and spend 3 hours walking the Riverwalk. That's why you need to come to Texas.
Oh, yes. The Riverwalk is very cool. I was there a few years ago. So thank you for being a guest on the Postmodern Realities podcast.
Thanks so much, Melanie. And thank you to your listeners for wrestling with poetry. It's not easy, but it's worthwhile.
You've been listening to the Postmodern Realities podcast from the Christian Research Institute and the Christian Research Journal. Today's guest has been Dr. Louis Marcos. He has written an online exclusive feature article about the poet Tennyson for the Christian Research Journal. His article is called Tennyson on Theodicy, How a Victorian Poet Can Help Modern Christians Deal with the Problem of Pain. And you can read his article when you subscribe to our journal for $33.50 at our website, equip.org, and gain access to all of our subscriber online exclusive articles. We'd like to connect to you, so please subscribe to the Bible Answer Man YouTube channel and join in the conversation in the comments section and in the live chat when we have premiere videos. Please follow the Bible Answer Man page on Facebook and on Twitter. You will find us at Hank Hanegraaff, Bible Answer Man, Christian Research Institute, and Christian Research Journal, as well as on Instagram at the Bible Answer Man account. You won't want to miss every Monday through Friday at 6 p.m. Eastern when we live stream the Bible Answer Man broadcast, hosted by CRI President Hank Hanegraaff at our website, equip.org. In addition, please subscribe to the Hank Unplugged podcast. Hank gets out of the studio and into his study and engages in in-depth, free-flowing, essential Christian conversations on critical issues with some of the most interesting, informative, and inspirational people on the planet. You'll want to head on over to equip.org because there you're going to find thousands of free resources for you in articles and past broadcasts, our podcasts, and videos. And thank you for all the ways in which you partner with the Christian Research Institute.